Greetings to all of my fellow surround sound enthusiasts. This is Dylan. This is my car, and I'm going to spend the next couple of minutes kind of going over how the surround sound system in the car works. First things first, we go into the trunk. You'll notice pretty heavy-duty amplifier back there. That's a 5-channel amp, and it powers the four corners in the car plus the subwoofer, which I've got hiding back here. All speakers in this car are Boston's. This is a Boston sub. So this is what's happening in my trunk. The amp's also a Boston amp. And it does a pretty good job. You know, I was concerned about powering so many speakers through a single unit, but it actually sounds really nice and clear and works very well. You'll see the various preamp inputs. That single one there is the sub, front, rear, speaker outputs, sub, and then power and remote from the head unit. So that's what's going on in the trunk here. Here's kind of a little odd curio for this particular car. You'll notice this little cutout here. That was designed for the original AM radio. You could have a single speaker in the rear. And I wish they would have put that in the front of the car. It would have been a perfect place for a center channel. Alas, no. I decided not to do that. So let's come on into the inside of the car. Actually, first, I'll show you how it's powered under the hood. Driving the amp, you'll see, is this wire here. And I've got a big heavy-duty fuse there to keep everything, you know, hunky-dory. Don't want to be starting electrical fires. That would be bad. Pretty big battery. It's got 800 cold cranking amps. Pretty heavy duty alternator too. It doesn't look very big, but it puts out enough juice to keep this car running while I'm driving and rocking out. So to the inside of the car we go. Put a couple of discs on my front seat here. Before I sit down, I'll show you where the speakers are. Here's the two rear speakers. These are Boston 6x9s, and you'll notice the shelf in the back is something that a buddy of mine and myself put together, propping the speakers up a little bit. I didn't want to bounce too many of the high frequencies off the glass because it kind of causes it to smear, and you lose a little bit of directional characteristics when you do that as well. So inside the car, you'll see the tweeters are mounted on the windscreen trim. And that actually ended up working out really nicely there. There's no visible mounting or wires. I was able to tuck it up under the trim there and tuck the wire in where the vent comes up. But you don't see any of that when you're sitting here. There's the tweeter for this speaker. The woofers are mounted down. You can kind of see my little boxes that are there. They're sticking out so far just because the other side of that panel is the outside of the fender. So the speakers had to, the woofers had to be somewhere. And so they stick out a little bit. I'm going to explore trying to find a way to get them to sink in a little bit further. But at this point, that's where the speakers live. And it works okay. Original AM radio, which does still work, by the way. And then here's the head unit. And I'll get my faceplate out. And go ahead and connect it, and I'm using the Sony SACD player. Put the keys in and give it some juice. See it all come to life. I'm going to start with this Jeff Beck SACD. Pop that in. And, you know, it works pretty much like it's supposed to. For the most part, anyways. Give it some. See, I can really crank this thing and it doesn't distort at all. It's really nice. There's that SACD there. You may be curious how it does with a DVD disc, and I figured I'd show you that as well. A little more cumbersome playing DVDs in this unit because there are some DVDs which don't play by default. And the other kind of thing that happens is some of them will default to stereo. Most of the Porcupine Tree and various Stephen Wilson DVD audio discs tend to do that. But you use the remote. I'll show you what the remote looks like here. I keep the remote in the side pocket so I don't lose it. The remote is the only way, with this button here, it's the only way that you can change the audio program, which is kind of a minus points as far as features on this radio. It'd be nice to have a button on the head unit itself. Here's Emerson, Lake & Palmer Brain Salad Surgery DVD audio. Obviously, this isn't a DVD audio player, so it's only going to play the DVD video portion, but, you know, it's good enough for the car. Honestly, this isn't really the best place. I don't care how quiet the car is. The car is never going to be the best place in the world to listen to high-res music, but, so here's the opening menu, where on your regular DVD audio player, it'd show the Rhino logo. And I think it just begins. Oh, it stops at a menu, so I'll hit play. Some of these Warner Brother discs have a false track one, so you skip to the next. There you go. While that's playing, I figured I'd show you the back and forth action of the sub. Of course, this isn't probably the best song for big heavy bass. There's a couple of bass moments here. There's the amp actually powered. You'll see there's a blue LED, which indicates all's good. When that light turns red, that's a bad thing. I've only seen that happen once. Here we go. Yeah, it's actually giving off quite a bit of bass, and the speaker's not moving all that much. So there you go. Surround sound in a 44-year-old car. I bet you Volvo never thought their cars could sound so good. That's it from Dylan, signing off.